Good morning to all of you. It's lovely to see so many faces on a Saturday rainy morning where the red alert has been issued in the city, and this really is a reflection of the enthusiasm of all our members. Welcome to this lecture on an overview of the changing landscape of arbitration in India. Recently, the Bombay Bar Association and the Advocates Association of Western Mumbai for the first time, had a joint managing committee meeting wherein we decided that henceforth we shall act collectively and try and organize more and more events together. And this is our first endeavor in that regard. And we are very pleased to hold today's lecture in association with the interactive session of women advocates. It's a group of very dynamic women advocates of our court who are promoting continued legal education amongst women. The subject today, an overview of the changing landscape of arbitration in India, is really current because there has been very few legislations in India which have been subject to so many judicial pronouncements, at times conflicting judicial pronouncements, in such a short span of time. And with changing times from our experience, etc., we have had legislations and amendments. And today we are here to discuss that what is really the changing landscape of arbitration in India. We all look forward to a very enriching morning. I request our President, Dr. Sathe, to please deliver the welcome address.
Honorable Justice Indu Malhotra, Honorable Justice S.C. Dharmadhikari, former Judge Supreme Court of India, Justice Gokhale, former Chief Justice of our High Court, Justice Mohit Jha, other judges of the Bombay High Court, senior advocates, members of the three organizations, ladies and gentlemen. I'm extremely privileged to welcome all of you this August morning, a rainy morning on a Saturday, to hear the discourse from Justice Indu Malhotra on an interesting subject, an overview of changing landscape in arbitration in India. I warmly welcome all of you to this historic High Court, and particularly this historic courtroom. And I'm never tired of mentioning three things when I'm in this courtroom. This courtroom has huge history. One related not to this court, but to the Supreme Court of Bombay in 1827, when the then Chief Justice of Supreme Court shut down the Supreme Court because the writ issued by him was not honored by the government. And the portrait of the legendary Sir John Peter Grant, unfortunately it is covered by the lights, but that's Sir John Peter Grant's portrait. The second incident which I narrate for this courtroom is the trial of Lokmanya Bal Gangadhar Tilak in 1908, which was held in this very courtroom. And his last words are inscribed on a tablet outside this courtroom, and his portrait hangs here. And the third important event which happened in this court is on the midnight of 14th August 1947, when the first Indian Chief Justice, Justice M.C. Chagla, took over as Chief Justice of the Bombay High Court in this very courtroom. So welcome all of you to this historic courtroom. Now this morning, Justice Indu Malhotra is going to speak to us on the changing landscape of arbitration law in India. The arbitration, as was originally conceived, as an alternate, effective, and cost-effective mechanism of dispute resolution for the courts, as an alternate to the court adjudication mechanism. But over a period of time, and the experience of 1940 Act and its successor 1996 Act has shown that it is anything but cost effective, it is anything but alternative, and it's certainly not cost effective. In fact, the arbitration today is riddled in litigation and has become virtually a pre-litigation and post-litigation scenario. Because before arbitration, there is a lot of litigation. Post-award also, there is litigation. And as has been famously said, that the real problem of a litigant in this country begins after he gets a decree, because his real trouble and problem starts in execution of that decree. In light of this, what I am reminded of what Justice D.A. Desai said about arbitration in 1984 in case of Guru Nanak Foundation, and I quote, "Interminable, time-consuming, complex, and expensive court procedure impelled jurists to search for an alternative forum, less formal, more effective, and speedy for resolution of dispute, avoiding procedural claptrap that this led them to Arbitration Act 1940. However, the way in which the proceedings under the Act are conducted and without an exception challenge in courts has made lawyers laugh and legal philosophers weep. Experience shows that the law reports bear ample testimony that the proceedings under the Act have become highly technical, accompanied by unending prolixity at every stage, providing a legal trap to the unwary. Informal forum chosen by the parties for expeditious disposal of their disputes has, by decisions of the courts, been clothed with legalese of unforeseeable complexity." That is what Justice D.A. Desai said in 1984, and unfortunately, that still rings true even today in 2019. Therefore, the importance of this topic and the necessity to debate and discuss this issue arises. And we are fortunate to have Justice Indu Malhotra to speak on that subject. And who else than Indu Malhotra to speak on that subject with her vast experience as an author on a very, very important treaty on arbitration law, the practice and procedure of arbitration law, a hugely successful book. And of course, she has authored large number of judgments as herself, as well as a member of the bench in arbitration law. So I welcome all of you, Justice Indu Malhotra, and every one of you this morning on behalf of Bombay Bar Association, Advocates Association of Western India, an interactive session of Women's Advocate this morning. We are all anxious to hear Justice Indu Malhotra on this very topical and important subject. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Dr. Sathe. On behalf of the Bar Associations and the interactive session, I would also like to express our sincere gratitude to the Honorable Chief Justice and Justice Dharmadhikari for permitting us to hold this event in this court today. And we welcome Justice Dharmadhikari for gracing, and we thank him for gracing this event today. I now request Ms. Rajni Iyer to please introduce our guests.
Good morning, everybody. It was such a pleasure and a delight when I was asked by the organizers to introduce Justice Malhotra to all of us. Justice Malhotra is a student of a potent combination of political science and law. In today's day and age, one can't ask for more from a judge who presides over the Supreme Court of India. Justice Malhotra did her graduation and then her master's in political science from the Delhi University, having come through Sri Ram College, and law as well from the Delhi University. She decided to practice law, but before doing that, her ability to communicate, as all of us will soon realize, made her also take up teaching while studying law. She taught, and the benefit of her teaching was shared by students of Miranda House and Vivekananda College in Delhi. She then passed and joined the bar sometime in 1983. What's the next challenge? The next challenge was getting into an office of an AOR who had come from Bombay, settled down in Delhi, and come to interact with all the top-notch senior practicing advocates in Delhi. I don't think there's anyone she has not briefed and given the benefit of her preparation. She didn't stop there. She then aced the Supreme Court AOR in 1988 and stood first and set up her own office as an advocate on record. Very many of us here present today have had an opportunity of interacting with her while she was practicing in Delhi, both as a arguing counsel as well as an AOR. how many of us have drawn her experience, do this, don't do that, etc. The procedural part of it is also something that she's very familiar with. And that's a great help when you are on the bench. Doubtless, so many of us have benefited from that. The important points as far as Justice Malhotra is concerned are three or four. After Justice Sheth, sometime in 1977, she was the first lady advocate to be designated as a senior advocate by the Supreme Court en banc. It means that even if a single judge of the Supreme Court said no, she couldn't have been designated so. Every judge of the Supreme Court was in favor of designating Justice Malhotra as a senior advocate. Having said that, what was it that really caught the eye of each of the judges of the Supreme Court which led to this? Three or four things again. Justice Malhotra is a second generation advocate. Her father, Sri Om Prakash Malhotra, is the author of the treatise that all of us grew up with in Government Law College, i.e. the Industrial Disputes Act. He was also authoring the treatise on the Arbitration and Conciliation Act. When he first started, his daughter, Indu Malhotra, was there, co-authoring it, helping him author it. And today, she is the author of that book, which has come into the fourth edition, and we'll be the beneficiaries of that very soon. Apart from being a second-generation lawyer, as far as Justice Malhotra is concerned, in April of 2018, when she was elevated directly to the Supreme Court as a judge, she broke another barrier, and that is she is the first woman practicing advocate to be directly appointed as a judge of the Supreme Court. En banc designation, first person, first lady lawyer to be appointed in the Supreme Court. The reason why I stress these little points is because as members of the Women's Interactive Session, these are the standards that each one of us can achieve. Each of us has to note it. It is not something that we have to better. It's a landmark that we can all strive towards. For that, excellence is required. Excellence and dedication of hard work. Justice Malhotra has put in over 30 years of absolutely hard work, which is what has got her to where she is today. Let us not forget that when we acknowledge that prior to her elevation to the Supreme Court, she was appointed in the committee which went into institutionalization of arbitration. Prior to that, she had been sent as a representative of the country abroad by the government of the day when they were discussing issues of child and marriage and women. I have a long list which I obtained from her office as to the various appointments and work that she has discharged, which are not judicial in that sense, but as a representative of the country. What really, according to me, I may be biased, really marked her out for recognition and ultimate elevation to the Supreme Court is her seminal discourse on arbitration. It's my go-to referencer for anything to do with arbitration. I don't think any of us today who do some amount of arbitration work have not gone to that book. For something or the other, we have always gone to that book, and we've never come back empty-handed. This, then, is what Mr. Sathe said. she is willing to share with us. We are all wanting to hear her and not about her. We are wanting to hear from her, and therefore, with a very big thank you, Justice Malhotra, I end my introduction to you and welcome you to Bombay. There is a saying that when something good is going to happen in Bombay, we get the blessings of all well-wishers and it rains. But see the quantity of well-wishers you've got today, it's pouring. With that, Justice Malhotra.
Thank you, Madam. Ms. Iyer said that each and every member of the interactive session should observe Justice Malhotra and identify the standards they need to meet. But may I say with utmost humility that excellence knows no gender, and Ms. Malhotra is an inspiration not only to the women advocates, but to every advocate practicing, not just in Maharashtra, but all over India. I now request our very respected Uma Ben to please felicitate Justice Malhotra on behalf of the interactive session of women advocates. On behalf of the Bombay Bar Association and the Advocates Association of Western India, may I request Ms. Sonal to please present a small memento to Justice Malhotra. May I now request Ms. Anjali Helekar to please present a small memento to Justice Dharmadhikari on behalf of the Bombay Bar Association and the Advocates Association of Western India. And Ms. Anita Castellino will present a small souvenir on behalf of the interactive session of women advocates to Justice Dharmadhikari. Thank you so much. May I now request Honorable Justice Dharmadhikari to please address our members.
Honorable Justice Malhotra, Honorable Justice Gokhale, former Justice Supreme Court of India, Honorable Justice Mohit Shah, former Chief Justice, my colleague, brother and sister judges, and senior advocates, lawyer friends, a very good morning to all of you. Today we have assembled here not to hear me at all. I have come amongst you very often, very frequently, and I am no expert either on arbitration or any branch of law for that matter. A simple thing that I know about arbitration was, and that has some significance, because we are celebrating the 150th year and birth centenary of our father of nation, Mahatma Gandhi. When he returned from South Africa, there is enough material that he was the first one who promoted arbitration. That famous trial between Dada Abdullah and Tayyabji Sheth led to his firm belief that once you tire out your opponent in the court, you achieve nothing. But if there is a conflict resolution method which is peaceful and there is a certain beauty of compromise, as he puts it, then both go satisfied. It has said that what is attributed to him is, differences we shall all have, but we must settle them all, whether religious or other, by arbitrations. People will take time, he said, before they accommodate themselves to arbitration. Its very simplicity and inexpensiveness will repel many people, even as palates jaded by spicy foods are repelled by simple combinations. All awards will not be always above suspicion. We must therefore rely upon intrinsic merits of the movement, and the correctness of awards will make itself felt. The method of arbitration creates misunderstanding, creates understanding between disputants, removes all misunderstandings as it resolves through compromise and cooperation without leaving an intolerable trail of bitterness behind. What we have been witnessing today is a scenario, as Dr. Sathe puts it, where we have completely achieved something to the contrary. We have decided to prove the father of our nation wrong. We have forgotten that an arbitration is a process by which one tries to settle a dispute. A person appointed to settle a dispute is an arbiter. He is not expected to be arbitrary, because arbitrary means based on or derived from uninformed opinion or random choice, capricious and despotic. In his process, it is not a decision like a traditional court of law, but it is a resolution through a process of settlement by a person appointed, rather chosen by parties to settle it. The atmosphere and the environment is expected to be informal, and rather it is termed as a domestic tribunal. But we have an unfortunate scenario, and that we have to now, as we were referring to the series of amendments to this law, even qualifications of an arbitrator. Now the amendments that are placed before the parliament prescribe even the qualifications, that a person should be qualified, experienced, with a reputation of fairness, integrity and capable to apply, objectivity in arriving at settlement of disputes, neutral, impartial, conversant with the constitution, with sound legal principles, robust understanding of the domestic and international legal system, was up till now a normality. That it has to be prescribed by amendment in the legislation is so unfortunate. Friends, we have seen that a law governing arbitration itself in India had to undergo several amendments. We have a survey of the Act, and it shows that though it is a consolidating and amending statute, what it does is to consolidate the law relating to domestic arbitration, international commercial arbitration, and enforcement of foreign arbitral awards. We have also noticed that this law defines what is conciliation. If we see the chapters, it is extremely unfortunate that such a law with comprehensive provisions to regulate and control arbitration in the first place itself had to be made. That it was there in the Code of Civil Procedure, but later on consolidated and codified in the British regime. In 1996, we had a new, completely new model of arbitration. But what we have seen in that less than 20 years, it had to be amended several occasions. Therefore, at least the rooted regime till 1996 went on for five decades and more. The 1996 law had to be amended several times, and in only 20 years is a reflection of how we have been really going through this process. In fact, this arbitration and the arbitration governed by legislation itself is self-defeating according to me. In my humble view, there was no legislative control and regulation necessary at all. And in a country which has such a dispute resolution method, informed by robust common sense, a practical approach, a pragmatic view, what else was a panchayat? What else were elders in the villages and cities doing but resolving disputes? Now that it had to be codified, means it had to be disciplined. It has gone out of control. It has also not achieved its purpose, is the general feeling. That for all of us is really an opportunity to introspect. We must also see that this legislation achieves its object and purpose by minimizing both the state and the control of the court. The intervention of the court was expected to be minimal, but as was said, it is generating more litigation. The reasons are for all to see. We have therefore seen that these many changes, modifications, interventions, what do they ultimately show? They show that we have not matured. We refuse to discipline and organize ourselves. Minimal statutory and judicial intervention, can it ever be a reality? Do we want resolution of disputes by this mode and which is stated to be alternate at all, is the moot question before us. I am not going to come between you and Justice Malhotra. I thank the organizers for having invited me and giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts and views on this legislation. Thank you.
I would like to take the liberty of expressing my strong disagreement with a statement made by Justice Dharmadhikari. He started by saying that he is not an expert on arbitration law. I am sure each one of us present here fully disagrees with that, and the rest of his address showed his deep insight in this subject. Thank you so much, sir, for coming and sharing your views with our members today. May I now request Justice Malhotra to please address our members.
Justice S.C. Dharmadhikari, judges of the Bombay High Court, sitting and former judges, Justice H.R. Gokhale from the Supreme Court, retired judge, Dr. Milind Sathe, President of the Bombay Bar Association, Mr. Sanjeev Kadam, President of the Advocates Association of Western India, Ms. Rajni Iyer, Senior Advocate, Convener of the Interactive Session Group of Lady Advocates, Ms. Anita Castellino, Senior Members of the Bombay Bar, Junior Members and students from the Law Colleges, my greetings to all of you. I am grateful for this opportunity which the Bombay Bar Association has given to me to come and share some of my thoughts. And I do wish to give a message to the High Courts. This is not as a judge of the Supreme Court as such, but from my experience of being an arbitration practitioner, of being a member and a sole arbitrator in various arbitrations, because I think a time has come for the bar and the bench to work in tandem in disposal of cases, because I really want to impress upon you all the aftermath of the White Industries case, which I will come to in a little while. It was in an investment treaty arbitration, an award was passed by the government of India, against the government of India. The costs which were imposed were borne by the taxpayer of this country, and the ground was that India did not offer an effective means for deciding disputes, contractual disputes, and that was the ground because the matter remained pending in the Supreme Court for 9 years because of the Balco case, in the Bombay High Court, and I'm sorry, not Bombay, Delhi High Court and Calcutta High Court. And this is the message which is actually in my mind. And there are certain provisions which the 2015 amendment had brought in, which are with respect to disposal of cases by the courts, which I think need to be adhered to with far more sincerity than we are able to do, because we are certainly an overburdened judiciary. But I think the solution lies in having specialized benches to dispose of these cases, otherwise the bottlenecks will remain. India has done extremely well in the last 3 years, I must say with pride. The World Bank has now rated us at number 77 in ease of doing business. The target the government of India has set for it is at number 30, and the enforcement of contracts is the biggest bottleneck which lies and which needs to be addressed, that is disposal of the petitions in the courts, primarily section 34 and after that the section 37 appeals. I think that is the main bottleneck, otherwise just getting an award as an enforceable decree means nothing. It has to be enforced, the procedure needs to be streamlined. And it is with that object in mind that I will give you a broad overview of the arbitration landscape as it has evolved in this country. In the past 2 decades, India has emerged as the world's 6th largest economy by nominal GDP and the 3rd largest by purchasing power parity. India's ascendancy on the global economic scene has had the effect of bringing the alternative dispute resolution system in our country in the spotlight. Historically, the public justice system was represented by state courts, but now the entire trend has changed. No foreign investor is willing to submit themselves to the jurisdiction of state courts. The cases come to the courts only for the purposes of enforcement with minimal judicial intervention at the preceding stages. Let me start with a very brief background on the legislative changes. The first codification took place in the year 1899 when the first legislation came out, and it was based on the British Act, which was also passed in the same year. But it was confined in its application to the 3 presidency towns of Madras, Bombay and Calcutta. It was in the 1940 Act, also a colonial legislation, which operated for a good 56 years, and it was framed to govern only domestic arbitrations. There were 2 sets of statutes. One was for the conduct of domestic arbitrations, which was the 1940 Act, and we had 2 other enactments, which was for the enforcement of foreign awards. Geneva Convention was under the 1937 protocol, and with respect to the New York Convention awards, they were covered by the 1961 Act. As Dr. Milind Sathi just told you all, I was in fact going to read that quotation of Justice D.A. Desai myself. In the Guru Nanak Foundation case, the way arbitrations were worked was really, really poor. Instead of being an alternate dispute resolution system, matters remained pending in arbitration, and at the drop of a hat, there were applications filed in the courts and they remained pending for years. I remember coming across cases which had been pending in arbitration for 19 years, 20 years, which was shocking. It was not at all an efficacious alternate dispute resolution system. Arbitrators would work only for a couple of hours. Adjournments were sought, routinely given. And arbitrators, I must confess, as a member of the judiciary, would actually treat it as an income post-retirement and would be very easy to grant adjournments because they would charge by every hearing. There was much to be expected both from the bar and the bench. 1996 Act came post-liberalization of the economy. It was modeled on the Unstrull Model Law. The Unstrull Model Law was framed in 1985 by the United Nations General Assembly. it was not meant to, it was not a treaty or a convention, it was a template which was circulated to bring about some kind of uniformity in arbitration legislation world over, so that there would be some kind of uniformity in the way matters were to be dealt with by domestic courts. The 1996 Act was the first arbitration legislation which was enacted post-independence. It was framed under Article 123 of the Constitution through the ordinance method. In my view, it is, even though it's a legitimate way of bringing about a legislation, but I think that the public discourse is lost. It's not an ideal way, but I think government was in a hurry to adopt the model law, so they framed it in that manner, and in its working for almost 20 years, there were a large number of glitches which came about. Courts got carried away. The second issue which I feel very strongly about, I think it would have been much better. 1996 Act came as a consolidating act. Domestic arbitrations covered by Part 1, enforcement of foreign awards Part 2, and I think this consolidating act also led to a lot of judgments which had to be modified subsequently. And of course, the main judgment was Bhatia, where the judges got misled by interpreting and comparing provisions of Part 1 with Part 2. I believe that there should always be two separate enactments, because they are two separate regimes. In fact, it is followed in, I think Singapore has two separate enactments, Australia has two separate enactments, and there are various other jurisdictions which have a completely separate enactment. And that is the mistake in which the three-judge bench in Bhatia fell, by making all kinds of odious comparisons which were unwarranted, and it took almost one decade for the Constitution bench to set aside that judgment and say that it is the principle of territoriality which is basic to Part 1 and Part 2. You can't transgress and say that even in a foreign-seated arbitration, Part 1 will apply. That was quite a fatal mistake, and India was dubbed as being an unfriendly arbitration jurisdiction. It certainly had its impact. Nobody wanted to come to India. See, it was a far cry, not even as a venue for arbitration. They were very apprehensive that the courts in India would interfere and widen the scope of judicial review. It caused serious misgivings in the international community, and also would have impacted foreign direct investment into this country, because a person, an investor who brings in huge monies, wants a robust alternative dispute resolution system. That is the bottom line. It is very important that we work towards a good system of alternate dispute resolution. The various disputes which emerged during the working of the 1996 Act were, one, with respect to Section 11, nature of jurisdiction. And this went on till the culmination in Patel Engineering, till the 2015 Amendment Act came in. There were various issues which arose at the point of making an appointment under Section 11, threshold issues, whether to be decided by the court or whether to be decided by the arbitrator under Section 16. The courts erroneously wrested jurisdiction to themselves to decide these threshold issues and completely undermined Section 16, which is based on the competence principle, which implies that the tribunal is competent to decide on all jurisdictional issues, including whether there is a valid arbitration clause in place or not. The second was on conflict of interest, particularly, and I had a very strong view on this, and I had commented pretty sharply in my third edition, that the appointment of arbitrators by public sector corporations and governments, state government, central government to make one of their employees as a sole arbitrator, I thought militated against the neutrality of an arbitrator. If that is the only round where you get to get your disputes decided, it has to be a fair process. You cannot have any kind of bias of the person who's being appointed as a sole arbitrator, particularly since the limit of filing objections is very narrow. This has now been done away with by the 2015 Amendment Act. The third was issue of arbitrability of disputes, which also engaged the attention of the Supreme Court in several cases. Fourth was the scope of interference by the courts with awards passed under Section 34 in domestic arbitrations, the applicability of Section 34 to foreign seated arbitrations, which came with the Bhatia judgment, and the fifth was, which I thought was the most important, that is enforcement of arbitral awards under Section 36 of the Act. The filing of objections would mean that the entire award remained in suspension till the objections were decided. And it took a lot of time, several years, for the courts to decide the Section 34. And during the interregnum, the assets would be frittered away, that it would be a meaningless paper decree in the hands of the person who had the award in their favor. The Balco decision, I feel, has been a landmark case passed by the Constitution bench, wherein they reiterated and said Part 1, Part 2 are entirely different regimes. But this judgment came to be passed after a long time, after India had got a lot of flak internationally, and especially to subject awards passed by international commercial tribunals overseas, and to say that they would be subjected to a review under 34 was actually a very, very serious intrusion on foreign seated arbitrations. In my view, had there been two enactments, this may have been avoided. Arbitration, even under the 1996 Act, became tardy, and the reason for this was because 90% arbitrations in our country have been ad hoc arbitrations. If there were institutional arbitrations, there is someone monitoring the progress of a case. That has actually been one of the banes. 90% of arbitrations were ad hoc. Arbitrators charged what they liked. They worked the time they wanted to. And so the whole system was extremely unregulated. And this is why Justice Ajit Shah, heading the Law Commission, I think that was one of his greatest contributions. I must acknowledge it. It was a great report which became the basis for the 2015 amendment. And I think that's the most significant amendment which has been brought about in the 1996 Act. Even though this Amendment Act was also passed by the ordinance route, it's a well-deliberated amendment since it was based on the Law Commission's report. The Law Commission sought to bring arbitration legislation in India in sync with contemporary international practices, and I'll just outline the main points. It enabled foreign parties to approach the Indian courts for interim relief under Section 9 without being subjected to a wider judicial review under Part 1 of the Act, which was the Bhatia contribution. Amendments have been brought out on the conflict of interest with respect to independence and impartiality of arbitrators. We have incorporated Schedule 5 and Schedule 7 into our legislation. This has been taken from the IBA guidelines, even though in the IBA guidelines were meant to be soft law. That is, it was only in the form of a guideline. India has actually given a statutory flavor to Schedule 7, not to 5. 5 is by way of guidance. Schedule 7 has been incorporated and is to be read along with Section 12.5, so that has been given a statutory flavor. In fact, India is only jurisdiction which has given these guidelines statutory force. Section 29, capital A, was introduced, which I think has been a very useful contribution to provide timelines for completion of arbitral proceedings. Arbitrators have been empowered now to grant interim reliefs. Significant amendments brought about in Section 17, except that they had actually gone and done a cut and paste of Section 9, and they had said before, during and after an arbitral tribunal can provide relief. So when I was on the high-powered committee for amendments, I told them, how can an arbitral tribunal provide relief post the award, because it becomes functus officio. They have no role to play. And that has been accepted, and it's been reflected in the 2019 Act, Amendment Act, which has been passed by Parliament 2 days ago. Then the ambit of the ground of public policy was clarified. It has been narrowed both with respect to international arbitrations as also with respect to domestic arbitrations. There has now been a tremendous change in the judgments which have been delivered both by the Supreme Court and by the High Courts. Supreme Court has given sanctity to a two-tier arbitration in central trade. Even though that was a peculiar case, it was a hybrid clause, where in the first instance it was a domestic award, where the tribunal was constituted by the ICA, and in the second tier it was an ICC arbitration. But nevertheless, the court has accepted it by a three-judge bench on the basis of party autonomy. Another judgment which is worth mentioning is Cheran Properties, where a corporate dispute regarding transmission of shares was directed. The court has directed the NCLT to give effect to this order. Roger Shasua, where the parties had only opted a foreign, it was an international commercial arbitration, where they had only mentioned the venue of arbitration, not the seat. The court took the view that the indication was that it was meant to be the seat, and London was designated as the seat of arbitration. In Shriram versus Rio Glass, it has now been held by the court that foreign awards do not require stamping when they come for execution to this country. LPAs not maintainable was held by Fursday Lawson, and recently in Kandra Exports, Justice Nariman has beautifully written with respect to a general appeal which a lot of people, lawyers, are always, they explore possibilities, so they filed an appeal under the Commercial Courts Act, because the 2015 amendments and the Commercial Courts Act of 2015 were contemporaneous. So they said that a general appeal is available, so why can't we approach the court by way of a second appeal? So in Kandla Exports, the Supreme Court has said nothing doing. It's a self-contained court. You can't go to other acts. And now the 2019 amendment has brought in a non-obstante clause in Section 37 to say that you cannot go to any other court. Then Bar Council of India versus A.K. Balaji is a recognition by the Supreme Court that even foreign arbitrators can come in on a fly-in, fly-out basis. The ink had just dried on the 2015 amendment when the Justice Sri Krishna Committee was constituted by the Ministry of Law and Justice, because they felt that it was time to support institutionalization of arbitration in our country. As I told you, there was a study which was conducted in 2015 by Queen Mary University of London in association with White and Case, where they found that India is a country where 90% of its arbitrations are conducted on an ad hoc basis. And therefore, the government felt that the next step should be to encourage institutionalization. We had recommended one was to set up a centralized flagship institution. There are a lot of foreign arbitrators who come to this country and say, your country doesn't have any centralized institution like Hong Kong has, Singapore has, etc. So the first thing was we addressed that a centralized institution be set up. The ICADR, which was in place, has now been taken over by the government, and they are setting up what is going to be called the New Delhi International Arbitration Center. We also recommended training and accreditation of arbitrators, because I must share with you honestly, there are a lot of retired judges of the Supreme Court also who are appointed to international commercial arbitrations. They get isolated on these tribunals. I was engaged by the Ministry of Petroleum in the Panna Muktar oil mines case, and the officers came and told me, "Madam, India always loses in its arbitrations." And there are, I think, twofold reasons. One is that the government is very slow and tardy for various reasons in giving instructions. So adverse orders do get to be passed, even though there may be a merit in the case, and so arbitrators feel helpless. The second reason is that when you become an arbitrator, when you retire, you must take off the cloak of being a judge. If you remain a judge, you remain in seclusion. And believe me, behind the scenes, a lot of liaising takes place between arbitrators. Recently, there was an international award passed in an international commercial arbitration with huge costs saddled onto India. And this was after I became a judge, and some of the lawyers who were handling the matter came to meet me. I said, "What was the reason?" They said, "Well, the foreign arbitrators turned around and said, your arbitrator didn't even say a word. Maybe we would have come down with the costs." So there's a lot of liaising which takes place behind the scenes. These are commercial disputes. They have to be dealt with in a commercial manner. You cannot remain in seclusion. You have to be savvy about commercial disputes and ensure that you are not isolated as a tribunal and let the other two pass an order. Believe me, it was very disheartening to hear that India was losing matter after matter in international commercial arbitrations. I thought it was a matter of serious concern. The next thing which we did advise the government was to encourage swift amendments. As the legislation is worked, you realize various pitfalls and they need to be addressed with swift amendments. And refresher courses must be introduced for judges at all levels who hear arbitration matters. We find very often district judges, when they hear a matter under 34, treat it like a first appeal. It's not to be treated. It has to be dealt with entirely differently. And therefore, judicial academies were advised to hold refresher courses so as to train judges how to deal with this jurisdiction. And one of my thoughts has always been that there must be specialized benches in every in the Supreme Court and in the High Court dealing with arbitration cases. And I will give my reason for it in a moment from now. The 2019 Amendment Bill has been passed by both Houses of Parliament 2 days ago. I will not dwell on it because it requires certain amount of scrutiny before I can speak about it. Post the 2015 amendment, as I told you, India has now been rated as number 77. We've climbed up by 23 notches. And of course, the target is number 30, as the government puts it. But I think today the biggest bottleneck is with respect to enforceability. And in a word which lacks enforceability is like a toothless tiger. The 2015 amendment had not only prescribed timelines for arbitration, but there are three important timelines which were introduced with respect to disposal of cases in courts. The first was Section 11, Subsection 13, that is, appointment of an arbitrator must be disposed of within a period of 60 days. I must share with you that there are many high courts where the Section 11 petitions are pending even today for 4 years and more. Section 29A, subsection 9, had said that if the mandate of an arbitrator is to be extended, there's a 6 months, it's to be extended, it must be decided within 60 days. It's not being done in most of the high courts. I was very heartened to hear today from Justice Kulkarni that they were being decided very swiftly in this court. In fact, Justice Chandrachud also told me that Section 11 are listed in this court on the very next day, but in most of the high courts, they're not able to do it. Section 34(6) says, this of course I feel is difficult to follow, it's an overburdened judiciary. We are catering to a very large population. 34(6) said, dispose of objections in 60 days. It is difficult, but I think the answer is not to say difficult and let it lie. The answer is have a specialized bench to do only 34. And why I say this is, I'll now come to that point. India is today facing 31 claims under the bilateral investment treaties. In bilateral investment treaty arbitrations, I will just tell you in a line or two, they emanate from treaty obligations of India with other countries where they have entered into these treaties. It is known as arbitration without privity because they emanate from treaty obligations. They are not between two parties. It's not between government of India and another party. It's between two states. So a foreign investor who comes from one of the states, comes to India, is not able to get his award enforced, he initiates a bilateral investment treaty arbitration, and that is what White Industries was all about. White Industries had filed a case against Coal India. That matter went to an ICC tribunal. The ICC tribunal gave an award in favor of White. White came to India for enforcement. They went to Calcutta because Coal India had its office there, and that is where the agreement contract was being executed. Coal India came to New Delhi and they filed objections, so matters were pending in two courts. In the meanwhile, White objected. They said, how can 34 lie? This is an international award. You can't come under 34. So the matter got referred and it was appended to the Balco case. So it remained pending in the Supreme Court for 9 years until the Balco decision came. During the interregnum, White initiated now a bilateral investment treaty against the government of India and said this country does not have an effective means of enforcing contracts or enforcing awards. The award was passed in the investment treaty arbitration against the government of India, and eventually who had to bear it? It was the taxpayer of this country. It is therefore necessary for us as a part of the judiciary and as a legal fraternity to ensure quick disposal of the cases. Today India is facing 31 claims after the White Industries Award. They feel India is a soft target with a vast population, and there are more and more claims being filed. One is for us to dispose of these cases, as especially the 11 and 34, they are most crucial, because 11, the arbitration doesn't take off the ground until the arbitrator is appointed, and 34, the award can't remain in a state of suspended animation for so long. It is therefore necessary for us to have specialized benches, and I think even arbitrators and lawyers need to familiarize themselves. They need to get accreditation, and there are very few lawyers who are familiar with bilateral investment treaties. Government of India has been engaging foreign law firms. In fact, sometimes to cut costs, there is a solicitor firm which they have been engaging even to represent the government. And obviously, that would not be an effective representation. India has some of the best lawyers in the world. They need to be accredited. They need to apprise themselves of what investment treaty arbitration is about. And it does not take much. 2 years ago, I went to Oxford and I did a course for 10 days on international commercial arbitrations at the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. I wrote out 3 exams for 4 hours each. If I can do it at this age, you people can do it far better. And I think you'll need to familiarize yourself with this to give able representation to the government of India in these arbitrations where the stakes run into billions of dollars, and they are extremely costly arbitrations. They are always overseas. They are, most of them, 90% of them are done by foreign arbitrators. Some of the Indian arbitrators are now getting appointed to investment treaty arbitrations, but they are unfamiliar with the lay of the land because they're entirely different from the 96 Act. In fact, there's one other piece which I do want to share with you, that some of these international investment treaty arbitrations, India has gone and filed anti-arbitration applications in the courts, and the high courts have sometimes granted injunctions which have been disregarded by these international tribunals. One is on the ground of territoriality, second is Indian courts have no jurisdiction to injunct these investment treaty arbitrations. So therefore, familiarity with this is extremely essential. These are my thoughts, and I'm grateful to you all for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Justice Malhotra, for your deep insight into the subject of arbitration. It surely left all our members enriched and also inspired to acquire better skills in the field of arbitration, and as you pointed out, particularly in international treaty arbitrations. Thank you so much. I now request Mr. Sanjeev Kadam to please deliver the vote of thanks.
Honorable Justice Indu Malhotra, Judge of Honorable Supreme Court of India, Honorable Justice S.C. Dharmadhikari, Judge Bombay High Court, Justice Hemant Gokhale, former Judge of Honorable Supreme Court, former Chief Justice of Bombay High Court, Justice Mohit Shah, Honorable Judges, former Judges, Senior Counsels, members of both the associations, Office Bearers of Bombay Bar Association and Advocates Association of Western India, friends and students of the law, I am here to offer the vote of thanks for this gathering. First and foremost, I thank, on behalf of Bombay Bar Association, Advocates Association of Western India, and Interactive Session of Women Advocates, to Justice Indu Malhotra to have come here and delivered a nice lecture which enlightened various aspects of the law of arbitration and conciliation. Thank you, Madam, for sparing time and visiting Mumbai and facing such rainy season, heavy rainy season in Mumbai. I understand my Lord Justice is worried about reaching back to the airport, but I assure that your Lordship will reach to the airport on time in spite of inadequate infrastructure in the city of Mumbai. I also thank Justice Dharmadhikari for having accepted our invitation by both the bars and the interactive session of women advocates to preside over this function and having delivered a lecture here. I also thank all the members and office bearers of Interactive Session of Women Associates who have made this function a great success. And first and foremost, and all of you who have come and attended this lecture in spite of such heavy rain since morning, I thank you all for coming here and attending the lecture. Thank everybody, and I also thank the administration and the Honorable Chief Justice of this High Court having made this beautiful hall available for this lecture series. I thank the administration for the arrangements made. I thank everybody who has contributed to make this function successful. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Kadam. Personally, may I take the liberty of expressing my sincere gratitude to Ms. Anita Castellino, Ms. Sonal, Ms. Mamta Saad, and Ms. Sharmila Deshmukh for the entire effort in organizing this event. If you look back today, while we thought whether there will be an audience or not, we are all struggling to find empty chairs. We have a packed house. Thank you, each one of you, for coming here today. Your presence really encourages us to continue in this endeavor of ours of continuing legal education. Thank you very much. Have a good day, and do join us for tea.